on the plate.
You gotta throw your fastball moving back off the plate.
When you come in, I'll get you about 10 runs and we'll have a lot of fun.
Boom! Ah!
What's up, the guy, huh?
Let's throw the bullpen right here. Let's throw the bullpen.
Played every inning of every game this year.
Swing the line, man!
Yeah. Back here.
It's Larry Anderson. Okay.
That's what I'm talking about. Nice night, baby.
Major League Baseball presents the 80th edition of the Fall Classic, the 1983 World Series. Baltimore, Maryland is the site of Game 1, a matchup between the National League pennant-winning Philadelphia Phillies and the American League champion Baltimore Orioles. And as Baseball Commissioner Bowie Kuhn throws out the first ball, the annual drama is about to unfold. The World Series arena is familiar ground to both teams. In 1979, Baltimore lost a heartbreaker, and the Orioles remember it well. While in 1980, the Phillies were decisive champions. For each club, a return to baseball showcase has taken hard work and a burning desire to be at the very top. In 1983, Joe Altobelli took over as manager, and his Orioles won 98 games, soaring to a seventh division title in 15 seasons. Pitching has long been a strength for the Orioles, and so it was again in 83, as Altobelli put together a staff that overcame the kinds of hardships that might have damaged any team's pennant hopes. That strength was evident in the league championship series against Chicago, as the Orioles closed out a rough-and-tumble set with the White Sox, holding Chicago to one run in the last 30 innings, taking the series 3-1 for their sixth pennant in 18 years. The Philadelphia Phillies' climb to the pinnacle was no less remarkable. In mid-July, Paul Owens left the front office to become manager and soon got his team back to playing its kind of hustling ball. Winning 21 of their last 25 games, the Phillies snared their division title for the fifth time in 8 years. The pennant came soon after as Philadelphia topped the Los Angeles Dodgers in the championship series. Now the Phillies would return to the World Series, a place where they found glory just 3 years before. All dressed up and ready to go, and the start of the 80th World Series is just moments away. Taking the mound for Baltimore this night is Scott McGregor, who was the Oriole ace in 83 as he led the team with 18 wins. And as time comes to play ball, McGregor faces leadoff man Joe Morgan, who celebrated his 40th birthday in September by batting .337 for the month.
Let it down, look down. Come on.
Playing in his fourth World Series, Joe Morgan is pumped with excitement.
Gets below the stands, really comes back quick.
With Morgan now on first, the next batter is six-time World Series veteran Pete Rose, and the Phillies are quick to show their aggressive style of play. Alert and ready, catcher Rick Dempsey is on target, and Morgan is out. Taking away the lead Philly runner, the Orioles are soon out of the inning. Pitching for Philadelphia, John Denny. And with one out in the bottom of the first, he faces Jim Dwyer. It's a home run for Jim Dwyer and a 1-0 lead for the Orioles. And with that hit, Dwyer becomes the 18th player to homer in his first time up in a World Series.
Away, away, away. Let it go. Let it go.
That 1-0 lead holds up over the next four innings. But in the top of the sixth, with two out, Joe Morgan is at bat again.
Let us down, look, Joe. Come on.
Paul Owens asked Morgan for a double, but the skipper is soon to have his pleasure doubled.
Get out of here! Get out of here! Get out of here! Come on, Joe.
Breaking ball.
Whatever the pitch, Morgan has hammered it, and the game is tied. Guarding against the letdown, a trip to the mound is made by pitching coach Ray Miller.
How you doing, Maggie?
I'm terrible, I stink.
Well, you pitched a hell of a ball game at this point. I know we got to get some runs some kind of way here, sooner or later. I think we have to, but give me a little concentration to hold them off right there and we'll do something, okay? Come on.
McGregor takes heed, and the Phillies are held in check. Through seven innings, pitching has been dominant. Each team scoring only once as the ball game moves to the eighth. In two previous trips to the plate this night, the eighth inning's leadoff hitter, Gary Maddox, has struck out and grounded into a double play. Finding his stroke at just the right time, Maddox has homered to put the Phillies ahead 2-1. And it's been a game in which all the scoring has come on solo homers. First Dwyer, then Morgan, and now Gary Maddox.
Let's go, Gary.
The next man up in the inning is Bo Diaz. Is out, and a replay shows just how incredible John Lowenstein's catch really was. Baltimore's brother Lowe going high to rob Diaz of a home run. And for the Orioles, that's something to shout about. Clearly, neither the weather nor the score has dampened the enthusiasm of Oriole fans. But through two out in the eighth, Philadelphia Cy Young candidate John Denny has been superb, retiring 20 of the last 22 batters as Al Bunbury stands in. Bunbury's double prompts manager Paul Owens to remove his starter.
Well, lady man, we like him.
Hell of a job, Johnny.
Good job, guys.
Hell of a job.
Well, we're right there. Let's win it.
That's right. We got him right now. We're going to percentage.
Yeah, that's all right. This guy's a good fastball.
I'm gonna bring in Holland. So. We'll get him for you, Ken. Hell of a job.
The call goes to bullpen ace Al Holland, and he's ready and willing to take charge.
Come on, let's go.
You got two out, man.
Let's go. Al, let's go. All right, put the threat in the hitter. Going right. Okay.
With the speedy Bunbury on second, pinch hitter Dan Ford is the man whom Holland has to go right at. But left fielder Gary Matthews stays with it, and the inning is over. Later, with two gone in the ninth, Holland is just one out away from wrapping it up. Once again, Matthews makes the play, and the Phillies are 2-1 winners. In a game attended by the President of the United States, brilliant pitching from John Denny and Al Holland made the difference as the Phillies enjoy victory in Baltimore. Wednesday, October 12th, Game 2. A perfect autumn evening. Joining the commissioner for first ball honors are Hall of Famers Brooks Robinson and Frank Robinson, each of whom represent a large part of the Orioles' winning tradition. Taking the mound for the Orioles in the second game is their outstanding rookie, 16-game winner Mike Boddicker. And through the first three innings, Boddicker retires nine men in a row. Now, in the fourth, it's nothing-nothing as the inning starts.
Come on, Joe. Come on.
Joe Morgan had two hits the night before, and the Phillies are hoping he'll continue to be a catalyst. With Philadelphia's first hit, Morgan is on and the wheels are turning. Catcher Rick Dempsey knows what to expect, as does Boddicker. The chances are good Morgan will be running. Morgan gets a jump. The pitch out is on. Morgan is safe. The value of that stolen base is soon increased. Later, with one out, Mike Schmidt is on first, with Morgan having advanced to third. And in a bit of a jam, the right-hander finds lefty Joe LaFay at the plate. Al Bumbrey is waiting, but his only play is to second base. Scoring on the sacrifice fly is Morgan, and the Phillies are out in front 1-0. That slender one-run lead holds up through 4.5 innings, thanks in part to the other rookie starting pitcher in Game 2, hard-throwing Charles Hudson, who pitched so well in the championship series against the Dodgers. In the bottom of the fifth, the first batter is John Lowenstein.
I have it ready for what you want now. Come on, John.
An outstanding member of Baltimore's outfield platoon, John Lowenstein belted 39 home runs playing part-time over the last two seasons. Now in the World Series, he's homered to tie the game. Having found their wings in the fifth, the Orioles continue to fly as the inning goes on. With another run in and men on second and third, Mike Boddicker bats for only the second time in professional ball. Scoring on the sacrifice is Todd Cruz, and the Orioles have to feel like they're doing a little cruising of their own. After five innings, it's 3-1 Baltimore. The Orioles add a run in the seventh, and now in the ninth, Mike Boddicker's looking to finish a masterpiece, and he's only one out away from doing it.
Come on, Mike! Come on!
Mike Boddicker has followed his 14 strikeout performance in the championship series with a splendid three-hitter in the World Series. And with this 4-1 Baltimore victory, the 1983 Fall Classic is all tied at one game apiece. It's time to travel, and whether it's along the Amtrak rails or on Interstate Highway 95, Philadelphia is only a short hop away. So it's on to William Penn, City of Brotherly Love, home of the Phillies, Veterans Stadium, and some of America's most loyal fans. Philadelphia is the city of the Declaration of Independence, and colonial roots are strong. Strong as well are the roots of baseball. 1983 marks the Phillies' 100th year, and the World Series is sure a great way to cap it off. More than 65,000 fans, the second largest crowd in Veterans Stadium history, have gathered for Game 3. And after seeing his team held to one run in the previous contest, manager Paul Owens has made a difficult decision. The Phillies' starting first baseman this night will be Tony Perez, 18th on baseball's all-time RBI list. And he's replacing Pete Rose in a move to try to put more power in the Philadelphia lineup. When the game gets underway, neither team is able to get on the scoreboard through the first inning and a half. Thus, with the slate clean in the bottom of the second, Gary Matthews, batting 400 in postseason, steps in against Oriole Mike Flanagan.
Come on, let's go, sir!
With his fourth home run in seven postseason games, the man called Sarge has taken charge, putting the Phillies ahead 1-0. Flanagan got past the second inning without further harm, and now in the third, he faces Joe Morgan. Much to the delight of the hometown crowd, Joe Morgan's second home run of the series gives the Phillies a 2-0 lead. On the mound for Philadelphia this night is lefty Steve Carlton, the first 300-game winner to pitch in the series since Grover Cleveland Alexander in 1928. And through five innings, Carlton has a shutout. But the Orioles later think that something with Big Lefty is not exactly right. And asking for a show of hands, Joe Altobelli takes it up with home plate umpire Al Clark.
He's got something else, too. Would you have him go wash his hands and then go to the Ross? That's what I'm asking.
I don't know. Ross can be sticky.
But he hasn't been to the Ross.
They might have they got Ross in there.
Well, why wouldn't he use it out there?
Maybe he's superstitious. Joe, not unless I see something. See the ball doing something. It's been done when the umpire sees something.
I'm tired of it.
I know. It's been done when the umpire
I'm
sees something on the ball.
That it's already happened this year that they made him go back to wash his hands?
No, I don't.
If I request it and you don't do it, what's wrong? What is it then?
Ball's not doing anything funny, Joe. There's nothing on the ball. Not until I see something on the ball.
Verbal warfare is one thing, but the real battle will always be on the diamond. In the sixth inning, Dan Ford came to bat with one out and the Phillies up 2-0. The trend continues. So far, all seven homers hit in the series have come with the bases empty. But Dan Ford and the Orioles will gladly take this one. In the bottom of the sixth, the Phillies are looking to increase their one-run lead. And with two out, Bo Diaz is at second, Avon DeJesus at first. Baltimore's Jim Palmer has been on in relief since the fifth, and Steve Carlton is due to bat.
Go ahead and hit.
Paul Owens had given thought to pinch hitting for Carlton, but he didn't want to take his ace out of the game leading by a run.
He said, you make the decision, I'll go either way. So I said, all right, go ahead and hit.
One of baseball's better hitting pitchers, Carlton works the count to 2-2. And on the eve of his 38th birthday, Jim Palmer in his sixth World Series is out of the inning. In the seventh, it's Baltimore's turn to threaten. With two out, Rick Dempsey has doubled. Anticipating the pinch hitter, pitching coach Claude Osteen goes to the mound.
I just want to make sure we got our wires straight on this guy. Dead fastball hitter, right. You're going to go break yourself on him, right?
Yeah.
All right, let's go hard. You're going to throw your fastball and move him back off the plate.
Pinch hitting for Jim Palmer, Joe Altobelli sends to the plate right-handed Benny Ayala. And after a wild pitch moves Dempsey to third, Ayala delivers. Rick Dempsey's run ties the game at two. Looking to his bullpen, Paul Owens makes the decision to remove Carlton from the game. Owens then calls upon the man who was so effective in game one.
Howard.
Double two.
Two
out, men in first.
But the Orioles proceed to put another man on base, and then up comes Dan Ford to face Al Holland. The lead seems to have changed so suddenly. Baltimore 3, Philadelphia 2. In the bottom of the seventh, Sammy Stewart takes over the pitching for Baltimore. Relying on a strong fastball, Stewart has been unscored upon in five innings of postseason relief. Now with two out, the Phillies are at the heart of their lineup. Slugger Mike Schmidt is up, and he's still looking for his first World Series hit. Those Philly frustrations continue into the eighth inning as well, as Stewart marches through the order, protecting Baltimore's one-run lead. And in the ninth, as far as the Orioles are concerned, it all comes down to one word.
Tipping.
Tippy Martinez, the Orioles' top reliever, has come on to stem a possible Philly uprising. And with two outs, Martinez faces pinch hitter Ozzie Virgil. Martinez gets the save, and the victory goes to Jim Palmer, the first pitcher to win World Series games in three different decades, as the Orioles go up 2-1. Game four, and the Phillies paid tribute to the 1950 Whiz Kids.
The first ball, please, Richie Ashburn.
Richie Ashburn once helped the Phillies win a pennant, and they're hoping a little bit of inspiration from a Whiz Kid can fan the Philly flame. But through the first three innings, both teams are scoreless. In the fourth, Jim Dwyer leads off against John Denny, and it's the Orioles who are on the move.
All righty, come on, Cal.
The bases are loaded, and after a strikeout, up comes an Oriole who's been mired in a surprising slump. Rich Dower, 1-for-26 in postseason play. In a series where the runs have been scarce, the Orioles have staked themselves to a 2-0 lead in the fourth. Now on the hill for Baltimore this day is 21-year-old right-hander Storm Davis. And after retiring the first 10 batters, Davis faces Pete Rose, reinstated in the Philly lineup. Following Rose, the next man up is six-time National League home run leader Mike Schmidt.
Hello, Mike. Hello, boy.
But Schmidt is still hitless in 13 at-bats, and the feeling is he's due to break through. With Schmidt's hit, the Phillies have runners at first and third with one out. The crowd knows it's a golden opportunity, and Philly is looking to cash in. Now Joe LaFay is at the plate.
Come on, Pete. Come on, baby.
Philadelphia picked up one run in the fourth, and in the bottom of the fifth, Bo Diaz is looking for more.
Come on, Bo.
Diaz leadoff double is followed by an infield out, and then Storm Davis finds his counterpart, John Denny. Battling back, the Phillies have tied the game. A ground out moves Denny to third, and next is Pete Rose. The bet is in a frenzy, and the Phillies lead 3-2 after five. But the focus of the game comes in the Orioles' sixth. John Lowenstein is on first with one out. And now John Denny looks in to find the sixth man in the Baltimore lineup. The Orioles now have runners at second and third, and with first base empty, the strategy starts. Joe Altobelli sends up Joe Nolan, first of our record-tying four consecutive pinch hitters. The Phillies counteract with a move of their own. Nolan has intentionally walked to load the bases to set up a possible double play. The next pinch hitter is Ken Singleton, Baltimore's DH during the season, and a definite long ball threat. But this time, Denny yields an unintentional walk, and the game is tied. Switch hitting John Shelby bats next, and Denny is taken out of the game. But the chess match continues as the Phillies call upon left-handed reliever Willie Hernandez, who works for the bases still loaded, to Shelby. Shelby is out, but another run scores on the sacrifice. A spectacular catch by Gary Matthews has prevented at least one more run from scoring. And the inning will end with Baltimore having moved ahead 4-3. In the seventh inning, reliever Ron Reed has to contend with Jim Dwyer at second and a man who already has two hits in the game, Rich Dower, at the plate. With his third hit and third RBI, Dower has given Baltimore a two-run lead. And that 5-3 advantage holds into the ninth, when it's no surprise to find on the mound left-hander Tippy Martinez. With one out, Martinez works to Bo Diaz. Once again, the wheels are turning. Paul Owen sends in fleet-footed Bob Dernier to pinch run for Diaz. Soon, an infield out advances Dernier to second, and Owen sends up Ozzie Virgil. Dernier scores, and the Phillies trail by only a run. Tippy Martinez knows the situation. Two out in the ninth. The potential tying run on first. And now, Joe Morgan at the plate. Len Sicada is there, and the Orioles take it 5-4 as Martinez posts his second save. Winning three games by a combined margin of just five runs, the Orioles are now only one victory away from a world championship. Taking a World Series overview, it's important to know that in today's fast-paced world, there's always time for a little laughter and a little goodwill. And who better to spread it than the Philly fanatic and his counterpart, the Baltimore Bird, each a league leader in laughs per inning. These two masters of mascot mirth are quick to share the spirit of the city of brotherly love, making a little magic happen. Well, sometimes artistic rivalry may intrude, but why worry? Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. Now looming large, Game 5, and more than 67,000, the greatest crowd in Veterans Stadium history, is on hand. The Phillies need 3 wins, Baltimore just 1, and every play is critical. In the first inning, indomitable Pete Rose bats against Scott McGregor. With Rose on first, the next batter is one who would like nothing better than to break out of his series slump, Mike Schmidt, 1-16. But if this out is any indication, it may not be Philadelphia's day. The Philly starting pitcher is Charles Hudson, and in the second inning, he faces Eddie Murray, whose series batting average is only 125. Finally, breaking through, Murray puts Baltimore up 1-0. In the top of the third, Hudson finds Rick Dempsey, who's had 3 hits in his last 8 at-bats. And the Orioles spark plug quickly ignites. The barrage continues. An inning later, Eddie Murray again. Putting his name on a towering blast, Murray has belted 2 home runs and 2 at-bats, driving in 3. Now the Orioles are rolling with a 4-0 lead. And in the 5th, the Birds add another tally, making it 5-0. But Philadelphia fights on. In the bottom of the 5th, Scott McGregor is allowed 2 men on with nobody out, Ivan DeJesus up. But once again, the Orioles turn the trick, and a possible rally disappears.
Fire boy, Manny!
In the 8th inning, the Phillies look to the top of their order and Joe Morgan for a lift. There's 1 out, and anything can still happen.
Come on, concentrate now.
Just as he's done throughout the entire series, always giving the extra effort, Joe Morgan stretches a double into a triple. Philly fans realize that they may be down 5, but with Pete Rose coming up, there's hope and a chance to get back in the game. And oh, what a disappointment. The run will not score. But perhaps it's symbolic. In trying so hard and coming so close, the Phillies have fallen short. In the bottom of the 9th, with 2 out, the contrasting expressions tell the story. Scott McGregor needs just 1 more out. Cal Ripken has it, and the Orioles have won the World Series. Baltimore becomes only the 4th team ever to win 4 straight after losing the opener. Oriole pitching was outstanding, topped off by Scott McGregor's shutout, and selected as the series' most valuable player is catcher Rick Dempsey, whose home run and 4 doubles set a record for most extra base hits in a 5-game series. With fiery leadership, Rick Dempsey helped bring his club to the place it dreamed of being, on top of the baseball world. Team play and winning go hand in hand, and there have been few finer examples of that combination than the 1983 Orioles. Now for the Orioles, their 3rd world title. And still to come, a joyous celebration back in Baltimore. as the city welcomes home its champions.